Okay, so we're going to move on now to a panel session, and I'm going to invite, we have four people coming up onto the stage. So if I could welcome, if you could welcome please to the stage, Brian Reid, he's the CEO of Delhi Lights, Karen Thomas, Supply Chain Manager for Norbev Limited, Mark McConville, Managing Director of Priory Press Packaging, and Clive Stewart, our Supply Chain Resilience and Development Manager, who will be facilitating the panel. Welcome up. If we have any time just at the end as well, we will take some questions. So if you have any questions, if you can hold them to the end as well, then we can come out with a microphone.
All right, good morning everyone. I'm delighted to see such a large crowd here today. And we're especially delighted to have our three panelists here to talk about sustainability. So I think we've heard Mark obviously giving a good insight into the importance of the supply chain. And I think everybody will certainly know sustainability is becoming a bigger part of that. I think the supply chain really plays a very important element within that. So what I'd like to do is really, Brian, if the first question goes to yourself in terms of things, can I ask you to introduce yourself and your company and tell us a bit about your sustainability journey and what you've learned along the way?
Absolutely, Clive. Delighted to be here. Brian Reid, Chief Executive, Delhi Lights Ireland Limited. We're a food-to-go business based in Warren Point, County Down. We supply the island of Ireland, and we're also supplying into 62 different countries worldwide now. So I guess our sustainability journey started 12 years ago when we realised that we had a business that was producing waste, and we wanted to look at the waste to see how do we make better use of that waste, how do we reduce it. And we started to do things like solar, we started to do things like heat pumps and using the waste from our refrigeration and things to heat our water. So we were building the sustainability journey, I guess, 12 years ago. But that's led us to where we are today, which we're a B Corp certified business now 15 months. And I guess the B Corp certification was a huge achievement for us to get it. We were the first sandwich manufacturer in the world to become B Corp certified, and we're very proud of that. We're still the only sandwich manufacturer in the world to become B Corp certified. But I guess it put a framework around our sustainability work that we were doing. So we were doing a lot of sustainability work in the business, and we've been doing it for years, as I've said. But what B Corp did was give us a framework to do that work in a structured way. And it helped us celebrate the other aspects of sustainability, which is your people, which is all about your ethics in the boardroom and how you treat your people. And it's a very transparent process. So where we started to where we are today, the sustainability is built into the DNA of the business. So my big learning from the sustainability journey that I've been on is sustainability can't be about just something that you do today to tick a box. It has to be something that's built into the DNA of the company. We have a value in the business called Be Responsible, and it's right up there in terms of how we run the business on a day-to-day basis. So it's built into how we think as a company now. It's built into how we go forward in the business over the next few years, and also then our consumers identify with the fact that we're a sustainable business and it's paying dividends.
Okay, sounds great. Thank you. Karen, if I can ask you to do the same.
Yeah, Karen Thomas. I work at Norbev in Ballymena. We are a producer of soft drinks. I would guess our journey really started 2018, and it wasn't so much seen as sustainability, but as a means to reduce waste and increase efficiency across the business. Introduction of LED lighting, VSDs. We then moved to lean manufacturing process. We reduced our customer base from about 30 down to 4. We reduced our suppliers from about 150 down to 40. So customers know, quality and delivery performance is a given. It's expected. We have seen a shift over the last number of years, a focus to sustainability from our customers. And there has been collaboration between them and ourselves. We've bandied about ideas, we've shared knowledge, we have really worked together to a common goal. So 2022 really started sustainability journey, if you like. We have since then reduced our Scope 1 and Scope 2 emissions by 50%. We are well ahead of the targets that our main customer set us to be achieved by 2025. I guess, as I said, collaboration, that sharing of knowledge and working towards a common goal has really been the key to our journey.
And what would you say you've sort of learned along the way?
Everybody needs to work together, I think. You know, we started out and we really weren't sure of what all was involved. You know, So we contacted INI, we set our baseline and then came up with a plan, a strategic plan of how we were going to develop.
Okay, and the great news is you're ahead of target, is what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And Mark, if we can ask you to introduce yourself in the same question.
Yes, good morning, everybody. My name is Mark McConville. I'm the MD of Priory Press Packaging. It's located just outside Bangor, near Conleague. We produce high-quality printed card boxes, cartons, for the consumer food sector primarily. We are also producing life sciences products into the pharmaceutical sector. Our journey to sustainability started, I would think, about 12 to 14 years ago. We were and continue to do a lot of branded packaging, high quality printed packaging for own brand products for all of the multiples apart from Marks and Spencer's. So Tesco's had come through, a supplier of meat products that we were producing packaging for, and had insisted on the sustainability statements and an environmental statement from all of their suppliers. Now that took us down a road, and we were fortunate at that time to have been updating some processes in plant. So commercial print onto card is a process of creating metal plates and putting them on presses that use inks. And digital, which we have, is good, but it is yet to meet the volume demand of being able to run a machine at 18,000 sheets an hour, all camera controlled and computer monitored. But back then, the processes, the option for instance, plate creation was changing. We were able to change our process from a chemical-based and water-based system into a heat lasered system, which cut out all of that chemical waste and water usage. We also had moved to a more modern production facility and a factory environment. And the first thing that I was faced with was all of the lighting in the place. So we went through and we got a carbon trust loan to replace all of the lighting. And that was an incredibly straightforward, incredibly satisfying and easy process to manage. And we were not going to be paying any more than the savings in the power we were using at the time. So that was all happening as well. Inks on presses were changing from mineral-based, oil-based, to more vegetable-based inks. And we had then put a very comprehensive system of segregation in our raw material. Our raw material being predominantly virgin folding boxboard, which is a global commodity. And as Mark was saying, in terms of production on Wrightbus, the types of card that are required for carton packaging are as different as they are in glass. You know, for sandwich manufacturing, it will require one sort of one grade, one performance. For drinks manufacturing, there's a totally different grade of card for frozen food packaging. So it all has a value, and the waste from it, because it's virgin board and it's going straight into segregation, that was an initiative that allowed us to start recycling. So one thing led to another, and I think that the key word that I would say for people starting up on a journey of this is looking at the certifications. So it quickly formed a strategy for us that we had to be certified to be able to make compliant packaging for our customers. So we have to operate under the certification, as do the food producers. So that was a BRC, GS, Global Standard. And we had to then attain that certification, which took a couple of years. Quickly after that, then, we attained the PS9000 Pharmaceutical Standard and certification. So, as was said, you know, this became part of our company DNA, working with certifications and systems and management structures. We then, like everybody else, and I'll cut into the mix here, that most of what we were making was at a time when supermarkets were getting a bit of a hammering for tertiary packaging and unnecessary packaging. And we were in a sector, in a production environment, that was making a product that was almost always going to be recyclable. It was going to be biodegradable, and it was going to be compostable. So we were off to a good start there. When we changed our plant, we were able to put in a press which had an aqueous-based advanced coating unit, which meant that we could get rid of processes like thermoplastic lamination, which ensured 100% recycling. We dropped window packaging completely.
So, sorry, I was going to say, Mark, what I'm reading into that, innovation is playing a key part in it, the sustainability bit, looking at the customer requirements, so there are sort of all the key elements as such?
Absolutely, yeah. And for us then it was a natural stage to look at the supply chain and say, can we offer our customers a certified raw material product? And that was the likes of FSC certification and PEFC certification, which we then achieved, which means if you ever look at a piece of packaging, you'll see a little tree logo on the back of it. That little certification number is our site number, and we are audited once a year, and that demonstrates corporate responsibility for the provenance and the fair trade and sustainability of that raw material. Solar came into the mix then. With the energy crisis, we had ring-fenced the budget to look at mitigating the huge rises in energy, like you all will have seen. So we put a substantial solar installation on the factory, which is contributing to about 25% of our power requirements. And
Sorry, Mark, I was going to say that leads nicely on to another area, because I'm very conscious in terms of our time today as well.
Yes.
But I think that leads nicely on to, in terms of, you know, the strategy that companies have implemented in terms of their sustainability side. If you don't mind, I'll ask Karen to start on that side on things. So, Karen, in terms of what strategies has your company implemented to ensure sustainability in the supply chain?
Okay, so we have implemented a number of strategies. As I've already said, we started focusing on the efficiency and the waste. We then introduced a purchasing strategy. We reviewed our suppliers in great detail, our shipping routes, our activities, service level agreements, and we developed partnerships. And I know Marcus already mentioned partnerships previously. As I said, we've reduced our customer and supplier base. We updated our supplier questionnaire and put a large section on sustainability to ensure that we were choosing suppliers who had high ethical and environmental standards. Innovation also played a big part. With reducing customer base, we were then able to sign long-term contracts with our customers. We introduced new automation at the end of the line.
Yep.
Reducing our usage of plastic wrap by 60 tonne in 2022. We, as I say, collaborated with our suppliers and our customers. We monitored market trends, reducing our bottle weights on average by about 8% over the last year. We moved away from virgin plastic to a minimum of 30% recycled plastic, and that reduced our virgin material by 120 metric ton. This year, well, by May, 95% of our products will be reduced from 100% recycled plastic. Okay. The other five is customer brand.
So, yeah, so it's very much a continuous journey in terms of what you're saying. Yeah.
Very much so.
And Brian, what would you add to that from your side? What's different? And
From our side, strategically, we said we're leading the industry. We feel as if we have a role in leadership in the industry to send a message out that we want to do things better, and we have a strap line, do right with every bite. And I guess 4 years ago, we put together a thing called a code of practice, which was a developed a questionnaire for our supply base to go out to the suppliers and say, what are you doing about sustainability? We're on a journey and we want you to go with us, but will you answer these questions and tell us where you are? We didn't get a great response, believe it or not, because you know a lot of the suppliers hadn't thought about it, and they were thinking, why do we need to do this? I thought it was all about price. And we said, well, it's not all about price. We want to see that you guys are starting to do some sustainability work yourselves. So as recent as a few weeks ago, I was with our M&S supplier and we were sitting down having a chat. And yeah, you had the price conversations and blah, blah, blah. But again, I said, you know, are you thinking about sustainability? Are you, you're moving into a new site? Are you thinking about putting solar on? And I could see their minds thinking, yeah, we do need to be doing this type of stuff. And I'm glad you mentioned it, because I just said, we want to be working with suppliers that also align with our purpose. So our purpose as a company is to sustain people on the planet, and we're a food company. So people think we're a food company, it should be about food, but it's not. It's about people on the planet. And we said, we want to make sure that you guys are thinking the same way we are, because in supply chain, if it's all about price, it's going to be a short-term relationship. But if there's more to it in terms of you're aligned with the way they're thinking and they're aligned with the way you're thinking, you're more likely to go on a journey together. And strategically, that's the way we were thinking about our supply chain. And it's also important to make sure that we raise awareness in our industry, in our supply chain.
Yeah.
So that's a big role that we feel as if we have in Deli Lights, is to raise awareness in the sandwich industry that we need to do things better.
So you're wanting to be that leading edge of, from your industry standpoint, and showing the way?
Yes, because the industry I'm in is very wasteful. There's a lot of waste sandwiches every day dumped, and food waste is a huge issue. So we have to play our part in that in the industry. And I'm involved in the British Sandwich Association, and I sit in panels, and believe it or not, everybody thinks they're doing things, but it's a tick box, it's token gestures. Yeah. But I would be thinking that we need to change the way we think as an industry and become more sustainable. And that's just the way I think.
Yeah, I think great example to hear on that side, yeah. And Mark, from your side, what else would you add to that from your end?
Well, what I would say is that once you have adopted a mindset that environmental sustainability issues are important to the ethos of your company, then it is, as Brian has said, it's a developing subject. You know, when I first started down the road 14 years ago, it was all about ensuring correct segregation, recycling, correct low energy lighting, etc. But you know, that has grown, and since the solar installation, which for many businesses will be a legacy for that premises, for that process for a good 25 years to come. So, you know, it has an impact that will be a lasting impact. I developed a vision for our product on behalf of our customers, that packaging should be able to deliver and show the consumer who buys it that the company making it has got a corporate responsibility for the carton that it's in. And for us, that apart from being compliant and qualified to do it, then we wanted to go towards being able to say, we will produce your product on certified renewable material, sustainable material, with all of the fair trade that goes with it and low environmental impact, using 100% sustainable power, which we are now doing. And, you know, at the end, the development was looking at your carbon footprint and looking at what we can improve there. To that end, we had a very low carbon footprint at 460 tons, which was not far off peak domestic use. Yeah. And we then consciously went and signed up to a carbon offsetting scheme from a certified body in the UK for a tree planting scheme. So it was kind of nose to tail. We wanted our entire production to be have as little environmental impact as could be achievable to date.
Great. I think that brings us nicely on to the next question, Mark. If you could briefly maybe touch on, you know, how do you start to balance the sometimes conflicting goals of sustainability and profitability in your supply chain?
It is a balance. And as Mark said earlier, you know, geopolitical influences on fluctuations of cost of energy, of cost of raw materials. It's a constantly moving target there that obviously to survive, we have to be in profit and we have to deliver a margin in what we do. But you can also build it in, as Brian says, to the DNA of your company. And if you set an objective that we want to get to this point, you know, things like for your staff, when the lease comes up on your vehicles, we replace them with fully electric vehicles. Where not only is it a benefit on the amount of fuel, and it had a positive effect on our carbon footprint, but also, you know, right down to the nuts and bolts of employee benefits, the P11Ds were better for them. You know, we've got some vehicles that are sitting getting charged with solar.
Yeah, so constantly keeping that sort of balance.
Constantly
in mind.
Balancing. Yeah. That was, you know, it would have been a lot cheaper to have petrol vehicles, but
yeah, well. Thankfully, you're looking in the right direction. And moving on, Karen, anything you would add to that from your side, from the Norbev side?
Yeah, I think it's you need to consider the long-term perspective. Mm-hmm. Just in a nutshell, you know, yes, there are a lot of costs up front, but weigh that against the long-term savings and the competitive advantage that it gives. Sustainability is a key objective. It's one that we talk about monthly at business reviews internally and annually with our customers.
So it's very much an integral part and built into your business strategy. Okay, excellent. And Brian, what would you add to that?
Yeah, it's been a difficult few years, to be honest. Supply chain and you were just at one stage, we were just delighted to have bread and delighted to have chicken because, you know, with the Ukraine war and with everything that was going on, we were just relieved to be able to supply our customers. But because we had to change our articles as a company when we went B Corp to exist not just for profit but for people and the planet, it just changed the way we think. So, as I said earlier, in the supply chain, you're in a partnership, so you have to work together with your suppliers through good times and bad. But at the other side of that is, how do I add value to the customer? How do I make the product better? How do I innovate? How do I make myself stand out in terms of the marketplace? And that's where the real value is. Mm-hmm. So, yes, things are increasing in your supply chain and things are going up. Like we're seeing chocolate at the minute is going up. But how do I then innovate to make that product better so somebody will pay more for it? Yeah. And it's not just seen as a price increase. So you have to balance, making a profit. And I think if you're adding value to the customer, you can charge more. But then you also have to work with your supply chain and not just jump the first time a price increase goes up. So you have to, it's been a very difficult environment in the last couple of years to do business.
Yeah, I think we can all see that. And Mark was alluding to it earlier. And I know it'll come up later as well about, you know, just that increasing need for resilience and focus on price. And I think that's a big part of why we're here today as well, you know, to highlight the importance of the supply chain and looking at stuff. So just moving on in terms of just, you know, last question. So Brian, start with yourself in terms of looking ahead. What future trends or innovations do you anticipate will have the greatest impact on supply chain sustainability?
I guess in the food industry, I think the big thing that we're seeing is a circular economy. How do we use ingredients that were previously in the supply chain before, like a byproduct of a beer making process, which we've used in our overnight oats and our energy bites just launched this year. So we're seeing how do we reuse ingredients that were previously seen as waste. That is a big deal, and if we can get more of that. Obviously, AI in terms of how we order capture, how we, you know, give the intelligence to our supply base so they can supply us better. And things like smart cameras in our production hall to improve our efficiencies. Automation is a huge thing for us now. How do we make, because the labor base is challenging at the minute. So those things are going to affect who can get you the ingredient or the product cheaper, quicker, and without leaving a big footprint. So collaboration in terms of working together, all those things are going to be, and the suppliers that get there quickest are going to win.
Yeah. No, listen, thank you very much. And I know we're almost out of time in terms of things. So anything very briefly, Karen or Mark, you would just add to that?
I would just say, you know, in terms of regulatory compliance, you know, yes, the big guys are already responsible for their carbon footprint. It will filter down to SMEs. Uh-huh. And as consumers get smarter and adapt, they'll force manufacturers to adapt.
All right. Any last comments, Mark?
No, I mean, what we have seen over the last decade is that the multiples will drive the requirements for our product and our packaging, and they'll be the first ones to say that we expect it to fall under such and such a legislation. Yeah. Okay. But the challenge is, I mean, heading towards carbon net zero, really we're up against things that we can't reduce, such as global transport. And
yeah, lots of bigger dynamics there. Mm. Well, listen, I think just to sort of sum up, I think, you know, it's very clearly, you know, all three companies, you know, you can see the highlight and the connection between driving, you know, supply chain improvements and the positive contribution that can make to sustainability around more efficient, you know, supply chain processes, productivity, linking into the ESG, et cetera. So I think it's been brilliant to hear your stories this morning. I know you'll be around for the day if anybody wants to ask any questions. So without further ado, I'd like to say thank you very much to the three panelists this morning.